Well, good evening. Certainly have enjoyed our time with you. Is this thing on? Am I on? Yeah, I'm on. We had an interesting trip down here this evening. I flipped the radio on and it said South 75, an accident at such and such place on the way down on the right shoulder. And it said on I-94, three different accidents, different places on the right shoulder. So I got to I-94 and got on the drive to get on 94, the entrance to 94. And it took nearly 15 minutes to get on 94. It was just stopped, backed up, and so forth. And then when I got on 94, traffic was traveling 5 miles an hour. I called a pastor and I said, you know, Pastor, I might be late. After I talked to him, just a little ways up the road, it said 13 miles to Telegraph Road, 43 minutes to get there. But thank the Lord, traffic started moving a little bit, and I got there in about 30 minutes. So got here just a little after 6:30. I like to be early. I know I got a fella that used to be my friend. I've got a lot of folks that used to be my friends. He's a preacher, and he likes to get on in the service just at right at the starting time or a minute or two after. First time he came to my church, he was 5 minutes late. He walked in the door, and I met him. I said, that'll be five demerits. Because I was still the dean of men at Midwestern at that time. And he was a teacher at the college. He thought our service was 7 o'clock and our service was 7:30. So he got there at 7 o'clock, left, and got himself a coffee and come back late. That's the way it goes. If you have your Bible tonight, turn to Luke chapter 15. Yeah, he was such a good friend that I heard him preach one time, and after preaching, we talked and just laughing and joking and carrying on. About 2 days later, I got a letter from him from his desk and said, I'd appreciate it if you don't ever come to hear me preach again. I said, okay, brother. I saw him a couple of weeks later, and I apologized for whatever I supposedly said. I offended him somehow or another. And then, of course, I had a fellow that pastor in the church that the building where I pastored, name of the church has changed. But he told me, I appreciate if you didn't come back. And so I just endear myself to folks. That's life, you know. I'm glad that Robert is the right kind of fella. Because Brother Miles is the former pastor of this church. And sometimes it's difficult as a former pastor to sit under preaching of the new pastor. Because it doesn't matter how much you agree on the Bible, there's always things you disagree on and so forth. And so it takes the right kind of fellas to say, well, I swallow my pride, he swallowed his, and I'll just go on and serve the Lord in this place. So we thank the Lord for that. And that's the only way it can happen. I know Dr. Malone pastored Emmanuel Baptist Church about 6 times. He retired, and then had another fella come in, and then had to take church back, and then had another fella come in, and then had to take church back. And the problem was the fellas who came in would not pastor the church. They're always afraid he's going to offend Dr. Malone. I told one of them, I took him out to lunch, told him, I said, hey, you do what you believe God would have you to do, and Dr. Malone will be okay with it. I don't know. I said, yeah, I know. I wanted to call him a coward, but I didn't. I was nice. You know, I knew Dr. Malone pretty well. We were together, all together, from the time I came to Midwestern until he passed away. Probably, I think it's about 45 years we was together. And so I got to know him pretty well. And he was a great man of God. All right, well, that's enough about my tomfoolery. And let's get into the Word of God. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 10. And the title of the message tonight is Why Missions? Of course, the number one reason, and I'm going to talk about some other reasons, but number one reason is because God commanded it. You know, that's number one reason. I'm not going to dwell on that. I'm going to dwell on some other reasons. But, you know, God told us to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So it's commanded of God. We don't have any options. It's like when a fella gets married. When he gets married, the Bible says, love your wife. It doesn't say, if you want to. It doesn't say, if you think you might like to. No, it just says, love your wife. So men, when they get married, they're commanded to love their wife. That's a command of God. So if you get married to a gal, you're stuck. You just love your wife. You ain't got no options. And that's a little different for ladies, because it talks about how the ladies are supposed to be taught to love their husbands. They don't necessarily start loving him till down the road a ways. And that's the way it is. When God commands it, you're stuck. Like when I told the Lord that I'd marry my wife, and we hadn't even met yet, other than I was in the choir and she was in the congregation, and I was singing in the choir, and I looked back there and I said, boy, that's a beautiful girl back there. And I looked at her and some more, and sang in the choir, and after a little bit I said under my breath to the Lord, Lord, if you'll save her, I'll marry her. I made a commitment. You know when she got saved? That service. Not another service. That service. So I'd promised God I'd gonna marry her. It took me about 3 months before we was able to get acquainted, because her cousin had told her that I was married. She wasn't gonna have anything to do with a married guy. And I was a youth director and so forth. And I tried to get her to come to youth meeting. She treated me like I had the plague. But that's been now 58 years ago. 55 of those we've been married. And so, praise the Lord. Make a promise, stick to it. And God commands us, let's do what he commands. But other reasons why missions. We've been reading here in Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 10. Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness, and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. Either what woman, having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle, and sweep the house, and seek diligently till she find it? And when she hath found it, she calleth her friends and her neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, I have found the piece which I had lost. Likewise I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your blessings. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for these thy people. Pray you'd help us to be a blessing and encouragement to folks here this evening. We'll give you the praise, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the reasons why missions, the simple one, and you all know it, but it bears repeating. You know, the soul of learning is repetition. That's why in our school system, public school systems in our day and age, we don't have much learning. They don't repeat things much. And I know because I've been involved with them for about 5 or 6 years now. Always giving kids something new, not repeating the lessons and so forth. So the soul of learning is repetition. So the first thing here is souls are lost. That's why missions, souls are lost. People are lost. We read about it here in this passage of Scripture. Read about the lost sheep. I used to chuckle when Dr. Malone would preach from this passage, and he'd always say, sheep are geographical morons. And said, you take them out somewhere, they can't find their way home. That's why the shepherd, when Jesus talked about the shepherd going after the sheep, he had 99 in a fold, but one was lost, and went out looking for the one that was lost, because he knew the sheep could not find his way home. And I know as human beings, we're proud and arrogant and all that kind of business. We don't like to be called geographical morons. But when it comes to the matter of salvation, we are. We don't know anything about it. We have to have somebody lead us. We have to, either somebody gives us a tract or points us some Bible verses, or they take the Bible and show us themselves, because otherwise we don't get saved. It's just because we are like sheep, and when it comes to salvation, we are geographical morons. We don't have it down. We're not going to find the way ourselves. We have to have somebody help us, and must have someone rescue us. Folks will continue to be lost unless somebody rescues them. You know, you can drop an old cat several miles from home, and he'll probably beat you back home. That's just the way they are. They're not like sheep. They know how to get home, and I've seen it happen before. And people try to get rid of their cat. If they don't take it far enough from home and don't scoot out of the way quick enough, that old cat follow them right back to the house. But not sheep. And that's true of lost sinners. They cannot find their way. It talks about another lost thing here in this passage. It talks about a lost coin. You know something about a coin? It doesn't know it's lost. It really doesn't know it's lost. You can throw a coin down on the ground, and it'll lay there till somebody picks it up. Lay there forever if nobody picks it up. Because it doesn't know it's lost. It doesn't know it fell in the crack somewhere, or fell out down the grate or something, or stuck between the floorboards. And they're content in their lost condition. They have no way of thinking or knowing anything about that they're lost. And that's the way with more people than we'd like to think. They just have no way of thinking about being lost. And oftentimes when you go out door knocking, you knock on a door and say something to folks about being lost or being a sinner. Oh, not me, not me. And they're just as lost as can be. But they don't admit it. They're like the coin. They don't know they're lost. And they won't know until we explain it to them and tell them. They need someone to find them. Jesus, of course, came to win souls. He's our example. Luke 19:10 says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. He's our example. So souls are lost, and Jesus came to save lost souls. And I'm saddened that we don't do a better job at winning the lost. I know it's there's some in some ways more difficult in our generation. Now, when I first got saved, people still didn't have many TVs. About all they listened to was the radio sometimes. They weren't bound up by electronic devices. And you could talk to them. I remember helping a fellow in a revival meeting down in Ohio. He was having a tent meeting in Salem, Ohio, and I was 12 years old, and I went and passed out flyers for the meeting. and ran house to house, jumped over hedges and so forth. That's when I could jump. And you know, just handed out the flyers. People came to the meeting and so forth, and had a great time in the Lord, because they really didn't have anything to stay home for. We had, in our neighborhood at that time, we had one family that had TV, probably about that big square, and so forth. And as a teenage boy, I'd sometimes go down there and watch a little TV with them. My brother was dating their daughter, and so we could go down and talk with them and watch a little TV with them. But there wasn't that distraction. But you know, today, you can't go into church without somebody playing with their phone. You know? I mean, they're distracted, even in the church service. They got to play that game. One more game. Just one more game. I used to tease a couple of boys in one church we were attending, and they'd come in. They lived together. They'd come in, sit down beside each other with their phones, and start texting. And I'd say, boys, you know, you can put those down and talk to each other. You don't have to text each other. They weren't texting each other, but I was accusing him of it. But that's the way it is. I mean, every kind of electronic device that man can dream up, we've got it. And folks are distracted by it. And now they have programs on TV that entice people to stay at home because they think, well, I got to watch this. Of course, if you're like most homes, not my house, because I refuse to pay $100 a month to have TV. I mean, to me, that's just insane. So I have a little antenna on my TV, and I get whatever locally I can get, and I'm satisfied with that. But most folks have DVRs and so on and so forth. So you can come to church because you can take and program that crazy thing and go home and watch it another time. And so I thank the Lord for that. And folks don't have to stay home and watch the programs. And of course, I never have stayed home and watched programs on TV rather than go to church. Church is much better than watching most of that stuff on TV. And so, but folks are lost, and they need somebody to reach them. And it's a little more difficult in our generation, and part of it is because of the distraction. And we see the distraction even in the highway. People driving down the highway, and they don't think they're distracted, but first thing you know, they run in the rear of somebody. They run over people. Now, I think now that they're saying that they believe, I don't know if it's true yet or not, but they believe that more people are killed by texters than are killed by drunk drivers. And put that crazy phone down. I don't like texting at all. Now, I do a little bit. I got one of those, what they call smartphones, you know, and so forth. I had a dumb phone for years and loved it. And but one day I lost it. Never found it. And a friend of mine, he gave me an Obama phone, and I used that for a couple of years. It's a dumb phone too. And you could text on it and so forth, but it was so small and you'd wear yourself out trying to text one sentence. And so I never did do much with that. But now I've got one of those, you know, like the pastor's got, similar anyway. I got it here in my pocket. One kind of back like that. Most folks carry those now. And so sometimes kids and grandkids text me. And even my wife on a couple of occasions. In fact, she texts me today. We rarely text each other, but she texts me today. She said, I'm having a good day. And I wrote back, good. we're not great conversationalists on the text. And so, but all of those things that cause people to get distracted, lose sight of what's important. We find someone else who's lost. The rich are lost. Not just lost souls, but the rich are lost. And I'll not take time to read an entire passage, but in Luke chapter 16, beginning in verse 19 through 31, there was a certain rich man who fared sumptuously every day, and a beggar, certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at a gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed from the rich man's table. And then the Bible says the beggar died, was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. Then it says the rich man died, and says those awful words, and in hell he left up his eyes, being in torment. The beggar went to Abraham's bosom, paradise, saved, comforted. Rich man never paid any attention to the beggar. Even if the beggar had a sign that said Jesus saves on it, he didn't pay attention. He never paid attention to the beggar. The beggar just laid there trying to catch a morsel from the table, a little crumb here and there, just to be fed. But the rich man, he thought he knew everything. He thought he could do anything. Why, he was rich. He could just do as he pleased. But he found out different, because he died. And when he opened his eyes after death, he was in a place of terrible torment. And he himself said, send Lazarus to dip his finger in water that I may cool my tongue, just a drop of water on his tongue. Rich men are lost, and his wealth, sumptuous meals could not save him. We saw from Ryan a rich man in Luke chapter 12. His farm produced so much grain that his barns could not hold it. So he said, I'll tear them down, build bigger barns. But God said, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. See, he thought he could do as he pleased as well. And sad to say, that's why Jesus said it's harder for a rich man to be saved. Not impossible, but hard, because they trust in their riches. His plenty could not save him. And verse 21 of that chapter says, so is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Both of these men thought wealth could save them, but sad to say, it couldn't. And then we find a rich young ruler. In Luke chapter 18, verse 18 to 26, he expected to be commended because Jesus said to him about the commandments, and he quoted the first five or so, not the first five, but after the first four, he quoted five or six of the commandments. Five of the commandments, which he had kept. They all had to do with human relationships. And he expected, when he told Jesus that, to be commended. But Jesus said, sell all you have. Come follow me. And he was sad because he had great riches. He had been a good moral man. We have lots of folks in our, even in our generation, that are good moral folks. We run across them quite often that would just do about anything for anybody. They treat people kindly. They rarely get upset and so forth. Just nice folks. But sad to say, met hundreds of them probably. They were lost. They, like the Pharisee, lost. Thought he was so good, but lost. And here this young man found out that keeping the commandments, and that's what folks tell you sometimes, oh yeah, I keep the commandments. I'm okay. No. Keeping the commandments won't get you to heaven. We find also the poor lost. In Luke chapter 14, verses 16 to 24, we have an interesting story about a master having a supper. In Pastor and I were talking about that the other day. You know, the Bible never talks about dinner. Always talks about supper. When I grew up as a child at home, my parents, my mom was from Tennessee and dad was from Alabama. We never had dinner at our house. We always had supper. And us boys would be out playing. Mom would call and say, "Supper time, boys." Because there was four of us boys. And if we was a half mile from home, we could hear Mom holler. We'd be back in the woods, about a half mile from the house. And she'd call for supper. And our little feet would carry us to supper. And here, a great ruler, certain ruler, great man, prepared a meal, supper, and invited those who were perhaps in kind of the same station of life he was. One had farm and material possessions. I'll just take a moment here and reiterate those. And they began to make excuse. One bought a piece of ground, had to go see it. Another bought oxen, had to go see it. Another said, "I've married a wife, therefore I cannot come." He is henpecked from day one. But he didn't ask his wife. I don't know any wife that wouldn't like to go to a nice banquet. Get married, go to a nice meal. She didn't have, wouldn't have had to prepare anything. But he used her for an excuse. We ought not do that, fellas. Ought not use a wife for excuses. Boy, my wife, she's a good wife. She taught me not to do that early in our marriage. And I'd say to her, "Honey, I need you to call so-and-so." She says, "There's a phone. You call him." I said, "I think you're right." And so when it was business I needed to take care of, I took care of it. And still do, 55 years later. But here this guy used his wife as an excuse for not going to a nice meal. My, can you imagine? So what did the master say? He said, "Go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city. Bring in hither the poor and the maimed and the halt and the blind." The poor are lost. You know, I live in Pontiac, Michigan. There are fellas that went to Midwestern that used to refer to it as the armpit of America. I don't know why. Guess they just didn't like being in Pontiac. When I first came to Pontiac, I would have rather went somewhere else. But the Lord said, "This is where you're going to be planted." So I've learned to be content and to like it. And I live in an area where one time I brought a deacon home with me, and I drove down the back way to the house. I didn't come right down Perry Street to Main Drag. I went down through the neighborhood and come back around to the house. He got to the house. He's turning white as a sheet and saying, "Pastor, we're going to have to pray more for you." I said, "Don, what's the problem?" He said, "Well, you just drove through." I said, "That's no problem." I said, "I walked through there." That's no problem. You know, what most people don't realize, as I said it already, but everybody is a member of the human race. And if people would understand that, you wouldn't have racism. Because how can you have racism unless you have two races? And if you had two races, they couldn't procreate. Because everything produces after its kind. So you know there's only one race. And so I have as much fun with black folks as I have with white folks and red folks and yellow folks and so forth, you know. Because they're just folks. That's what they are, folks. And so I invite them to church. I've got a neighbor who lives up the street a little bit, a couple of houses up on the other side of the street. I hope he don't never get killed walking over to my house to borrow money, but he walks over. He caught me, let's see, Monday evening, I think it was. Or no, Monday afternoon. I went out to the mailbox, and here he come. Here come Bernard. And he said, "Hey, preacher." I said, "Yeah, how you doing?" He said, "I'm doing great." Comes over and begins to tell me this person died and that person died. "I've just had so many expenses, preacher. Can you loan me $10? Now, most of the time, if I got it in my pocket, he gets it. Because that's just what the Bible says. He's my neighbor. And he's much better tan than I have. He's pretty dark. But he claims he's saved, and so forth. Talks about the Lord when he comes down. Whether he knows anything about the Lord, I don't know. He just sounds like he does. But he come by and he said all this stuff. And he said, "Preacher, I need $10. I said, "I think I got $10. Now, strange thing. First time he ever borrowed money off of me. I said, "Now, I want you to understand, I never loan money. I don't loan money." Now, he calls it a loan. But if he don't ever give it back, that'll be just fine. Because I don't loan it. But the strange thing, so far, every time I've given him money, several days later, he gives it back. I mean, that's fine. But if he didn't ever give it back, he's just as welcome to it as anything. We need to get out the gospel to the poor. And Jesus instructed us. Then there's somebody else that's lost. The religious are lost. You know, religion sends probably more people to hell than anything else. That Pharisee there in Luke chapter 18, he went and prayed and said, "Thank you, Lord, I'm not like other men are. Even this publican, I do this and I do that and I do something else." He had lots of eye trouble. And the publican said, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." And Jesus said, the publican went down to his house justified, just as if he had never sinned. But the publican, I mean the Pharisee, went away in the same old sin he had when he got there. No forgiveness. Went away, what we would say physically, we'd say a good man went away and went to hell, and a bad man went away and went to heaven. So we need to understand, folks are lost. Matthew 5:20 says, "Except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall no case enter in the kingdom of heaven." So we find the world is lost. John 3:16. John 1:10 says, "He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not." We have all these reasons why we must win souls. 1 John 5:19 says, "And we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness." We need to win souls because the world lies in wickedness. Everyone that cannot answer the question, if you were to die today, do you know where you would spend eternity? They're lost if they can't answer that question. If you cannot say you're saved and on your way to heaven, you're lost. If you know you're saved, then you're on your way to heaven and must do your part to save others. When we look at the religious world, we find that Protestants, Catholics, and other religions, they're all part of our mission field. Now, are there some folks that maybe go to some of the Protestant churches that are saved? I think so. I've had some relatives that were in other churches, and they gave a clear testimony of salvation and so on. Excuse me. But for the most part, because the emphasis in all those denominations, the main emphasis is works. If you do works, you get saved. It's not salvation by grace. And so for the most part, they need to be saved. I have a preacher friend, he was Lutheran before he got saved, and he says, all Lutherans are lost. He may be right, I don't know. I'm not God. I'm glad I'm not. God makes has the record, and he keeps the record. A friend of mine, Wilson Ewan, at which the Paulies, for about 4 months, Brother Paulie was his pastor. Wilson Ewan was a missionary in Canada several years before the Paulies got there. And he came to Midwestern one time and told us that he was set on fire by the Catholics for preaching the gospel, 1948 in Quebec. And he said, all Catholics are lost, without question. Well, I'm not God, I don't know. But I do know my responsibility is to try to witness to them to see if they're saved or lost. And so we need to do our part. Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace are you saved, that through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And then in the book of Jude it says, but ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. We need to be filled with Holy Spirit power. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And of some have compassion, making a difference. Oftentimes, when I'm walking the hallways at the public school, kids will kind of be in a little tiff and so forth, or touching one another. I'll say, wait a second, be kind. Be compassionate. Keep your hands to yourself, then you won't get mad. Because the easiest way for folks to get in a fuss is start touching one another. Now, they might start out just playing, but if you let it go, next thing you know, they're slugging it out. But as a Christian, the Bible tells us, have some compassion, making a difference. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garments spotted by the flesh. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God our Savior be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. May God help us to recognize folks are lost, to recognize that we are responsible to do our part, to try to reach them with the gospel. Let's bow in prayer. Father, we truly thank you for your blessings. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for each one here tonight. I pray, Lord, that you'd speak to each of our hearts and minds. And Lord, if we need to come and use the altar and get some things settled with you, may we do that tonight.